my heart, Lord, as I lift up my hand. I'm wounded, I'm battered, and I'm undone by my own circumstance. Now my life has been shattered, but I give it all to you, yeah. 'Cause so many times I tried to win on my own, but without you, Lord, I'm destined to lose. Oh, you alone.
All that I want.
Yes, and you're all that I need.
All that I need.
I'll keep on. I come to you with a heavy spirit. You said brokenness, you won't turn away. So I fall on my knees and I pray to the Lord as the tears roll down my face. So just one touch of my Savior's goodness is enough to drive my storm away, yeah. So I'm coming to you, Lord, and I'm reaching for you, Jesus, because I know you're the only one that can say you are. Keep holding on. Until he bless your soul. It may not look good right now, but keep on pressing towards your blessing. Don't let go until he bless your soul.
Yeah.
morning, Christian Fellowship.
We are so glad that you are here and joining us this morning. Listen, I don't want you to get it twisted that because you see us singing or playing instruments that we have it all together or that life doesn't bring us some kind of hardship. The only difference may be because I sing about a mighty God that I truly believe. That he's a mighty God, and that all things work together for the good of those who are in Christ Jesus. And I'm in him this morning, amen? So what I do is encourage you today to sing his praises. We serve a mighty God, and all you have to do is believe. Amen?
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh yes.
Lord, you're mighty. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. You set your glory above the heavens and the earth. When I think of all you made, the sun, the moon, and the stars, no praise is high enough to express how great you are. Lord, is your name in all the earth. You set your glory above the heavens and the earth. When I think of all you made, the sun, the moon, and the stars, no place is high enough to express how great you are.
Angels bow before
Come on and give him some praise this morning. He's worthy. Yes, he is.
No matter what.
No matter what. The problems they bring.
God's in control.
He's in control and he knows everything.
I have the victory,
for he is my king.
In
my life, moving half my pain.
No matter what,
the problems may bring.
He's
in control, yes, he knows everything.
I have the victory,
for he is my king.
In
him, I live, moving half my pain.
Hey,
he will be. Oh, lift him up, rejoice.
Shout it again.
And shout unto God, for you have caused us to triumph.
And we know
we
know
we are ruling the end.
Let the people be.
Oh, lift him up, rejoice.
Shout it again.
And shout unto God, for you have caused us to triumph.
We know
we
know
we are ruling the end.
God's in control.
He's in control.
Yes, he is.
Everything.
I have a victory.
I have a victory, for he is my king.
In him we live.
In him we have a victory.
No matter, no matter what.
No matter what.
No.
Your problems may bring.
God's in control.
In control.
Yes, he is.
Everything.
I have a victory.
I have a victory, for he is my king.
In him we live.
Oh,
all of the people.
Lift up, lift up, rejoice.
Shout unto God.
And shout unto God, for you have caused us to try.
If we know
we
can
rule in the
let the people
let be. Oh, lift him up,
rejoice. Shout unto God.
And shout unto God, for you have caused us to try.
If we know
we
can
lift him up, lift him up, lift him up, higher and higher. Lift him up, lift him up, lift him up, higher and higher. Lift him up, lift him up, lift him up, higher and higher. Lift him up, lift him up, lift him up.
Good morning, Christian Fellowship.
Good morning.
We're getting ready for our scripture reading. And I'm going to give you a few moments to find it in your Bible. We're in Philippians chapter number 3. We're in verses 17 through 21. So I'm going to give you a little time. Philippians chapter number 3, verses 17 through 21. And in reverence to God's word, I would ask if you could stand. If not, make yourself comfortable, but make sure you have God's word right in front of you. And you know, it kind of reminds me of how Nehemiah read, and they stood for 8 hours listening to the word of God. So we want to give reverence to God's word just as well, just for these few passages of scriptures. Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through 21 reads as follows. It says, "Join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. For as I have often told you before, and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body." May the Lord have a blessing to the hearing and reading of his word.
When the next general election rolls around, who will be eligible to show up at the polls and vote for the President of the United States? It's really pretty simple. If you are at least 18 years old, a citizen of the U.S., and a resident of a state, you can vote. Assuming, that is, you're not a felon. Seems about right. After all, the United States prides itself on being a democracy, or a government in which the ultimate authority lies with the citizens of the nation. But it was not always this way. In 1789, George Washington won the Electoral College with 100% of the vote. But whose vote was it? Probably not yours. Only 6% of the entire United States population was allowed to vote at all. Voting was a right that only white male property owners were allowed to exercise. By the 1820s and 1830s, the American population was booming from the East Coast into the Western frontier. Frontier farmers were resilient, self-reliant, and mostly ineligible to vote because they did not own land. As these new areas of the nation became states, they typically left out the property requirement for voting. Leaders such as Andrew Jackson, the United States' first common man president, promoted what he called universal suffrage. Of course, by universal suffrage, Jackson really meant universal white male suffrage. All he emphasized was getting rid of the property requirement for voting, not expanding the vote beyond white men. By the 1850s, about 55% of the adult population was eligible to vote in the U.S., much better than 6%, but far from everybody. Then, in 1861, the American Civil War began largely over the issue of slavery and states' rights in the United States. When it was all over, the U.S. ratified the 15th Amendment, which promised that a person's right to vote could not be denied based on race, color, or previous condition as a slave. This meant that black men, newly affirmed as citizens of the U.S., would now be allowed to vote. Of course, laws are far from reality. Despite the promise of the 15th Amendment, intimidation kept African Americans from exercising their voting rights. States passed laws that limited the rights of African Americans to vote, including things like literacy tests, which were rigged so that not even literate African Americans were allowed to pass, and poll taxes. So, despite the 15th Amendment, by 1892, only about 6% of black men in Mississippi were registered to vote. By 1960, it was only 1%. And of course, women were still totally out of the national voting picture. It wasn't until 1920 that the women's suffrage movement won their 30-year battle, and the 19th Amendment finally gave women the vote. Well, white women. The restrictions on African Americans, including African American women, remained. After World War II, many Americans began to question the state of U.S. democracy. How could a nation that fought for freedom and human rights abroad come home and deny suffrage based on race? The modern civil rights movement began in the 1940s with those questions in mind. After years of sacrifice, bloodshed, and pain, the United States passed the Voting Rights Act of 1965, finally eliminating restrictions such as literacy tests and protecting the voting rights promised under the 15th Amendment to the Constitution. Now, any citizen over the age of 21 could vote. All seemed well. until the United States went to war. When the Vietnam War called up all men age 18 and over for the draft, many wondered whether it was fair to send men who couldn't vote to war. In 1971, the 26th Amendment to the Constitution made all citizens 18 and older eligible to vote, the last major expansion of voting rights in the United States. Today, the pool of eligible voters in the U.S. is far broader and more inclusive than ever before in U.S. history. But, of course, it's not perfect. There are still active efforts to suppress some groups from voting, and only about 60% of those who can vote do. Now that you know all the hard work that went into securing the right to vote, what do you think? Do enough citizens have the right to vote now? And among those who can vote, why don't more of them do it?
Hallelujah. Just know that our God is sovereign. And no matter what your circumstances are, He's in control. And it just makes sense to surrender yourself to Him and worship. Hallelujah.
My mind, your love, my heart, He's all of me. Oh, yes.
Your thoughts stay on my mind.
Thank you, Jesus.
Live in me.
Yeah, yeah.
Your songs flow through my lips.
Yes.
Your word flows through my hands.
Oh, yes.
Your thoughts stay on my mind. Live in me.
Yeah, yeah.
'Cause you can have all that I need.
Hallelujah.
Have all.
This morning, for all of those who are out there watching you this morning, I want to give you a little food for thought. Suppose you could take every bill that you ever accumulated, lay them all in order on a table, and someone would come along and pay every bill that you owe. Be kind of hard to forget them, wouldn't it? But think about someone who would come along, pay every bill that you ever owed, and then give you money where you would never run out, no matter what kind of bill you created. When we think about Jesus Christ this morning, he paid a sin debt that we could never pay. And most people have a tendency to just look at sins forgiven. But I want you to know that this morning that as we do our communion, think about Christ releasing you from the dominion of sin. Think about him placing you in a situation to where you stand before God. You got a notice paid in full. That is the reason we celebrate. Scripture tells us that on the day that Jesus was to be betrayed, he took his disciples and he gathered them into an upper room. And he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and said, take this, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Likewise, he took the cup also. And he said, take and drink ye, for this is the blood of the New Testament. When we look back over 2,000 years ago, we understand it a little bit better than the disciples would have understood it, because they were actually at that particular point in time looking for an earthly king that would come in and relieve them of Roman oppression. But when we look forward, how many know sometimes we need someone to deliver us from ourselves? And that's one of the things Jesus does for us. Father, we just come before you this morning. God, and we thank you for everything that we tend to take for granted on a daily basis. Because we know that who we are is because of you. We take the small things for granted sometimes, like even the very air that we breathe, it belongs to you. We thank you that you watched over us last night. You got us up in peace this morning. And you fixed it even in the way of all of the mist of what's going on in the world. You made it possible for each and every one of us to have some Jesus. And we thank you for that. Father, we ask today that you would bless all of those who are participating with us. We ask that you would bless all of the hearers and the listeners. And give them hope that brighter days are coming. We pray also that you would bless Pastor Archie as he presents the message today. And we pray that you would allow everybody to hear, but hear in such a way that they listen and it moves them to action. And I also pray in closing that we never lose hope of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Help us to be a people that live not just on a Sunday, but in an atmosphere of praise and worship on a daily basis. And we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. And let us all say,
amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. He's worthy to be praised. No matter how we look at it, he's worthy to be praised. And I want to challenge every believer right now to just lift your hands no matter where you are and just give him praise and glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Great is your mercy towards me. Your loving kindness towards me.
Yes, yes, yes.
Your tender mercy I see day after day. Forever faithful towards me.
Yes.
Always providing for me. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your grace. Great is your mercy towards me. Your loving kindness towards me. Your tender mercies I see day after day. Always providing for me. Great is your mercy towards me. Great is your grace.
Great is your mercy towards me.
Hallelujah.
Your tender mercy
Your mercy I see day after day. Forever, 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 forever faithful, yeah. You've been faithful towards me. You've always provided for me, me and my family, yeah. Great is your mercy, your mercy, your mercy towards me. Great is your grace. Great is your mercy towards me. Your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercies I see.
Come on, Marquita.
Day after day. Great is your mercy towards me, your loving kindness towards me, your tender mercies I see.
Once again, Christian Fellowship. And we're all the time trying to provide you with the most personal worship service we can possibly give you. Pastor Archie is working on some technology. The singers are coming out here on a weekly basis to provide the best possible worship service we can give you, considering the fact that we're in a pandemic and we can't be here all together. So in saying that, we have the opportunity to give. And the way we do that is trust God. And the way we can do that is actually, there's four ways. We have an app which can be found in your Apple Store or Android Apple Store, and that's CFBC. Also, we have a mailing address, which is P.O. Box 16197, and that's Kansas City, Missouri, 64112. Also, there's a Cash App, and that is $CFBC4515. You can also text to give. And that number is 1-660-204-4279. Text the amount you want to give, and the instructions will follow. So as we prepare to hear God's word, pray for Pastor Archie. And understand, as you study God's word, and it's not just on Sunday, study God's word so we don't forget that we have a real responsibility not to just give on Sunday, but to give of our time, talents, and treasures throughout the week. There's someone that's needing the light of Christ, and we need to express that in all that we do. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. It is good to have you here today, and it's good to be here. God is good, and this is an interesting time in our history. First of all, I want to thank everybody who celebrated with us, even though we were socially distant, celebrated with us our 37-year celebration of marriage, my wife and I. We appreciated all the cards, the thank yous, and all the stuff that we received from you, and most of all, we appreciate the love that we receive from you. At this time, we're going to go to the Word of God in prayer, and then dive into, we'll start off with Philippians chapter number 3, but we'll dance around a little bit because it's much more topical as we talk about the Bible and the ballot box. So let's go to God in prayer. God, we thank you so much that you are such an awesome God. We really appreciate the fact that you saved us comprehensively. I mean, we weren't just saved with a ticket to heaven, but you also have expectations for us as we live on earth, and you help us drive through those road challenges with you in mind. Father, we ask that you would bless us today. Let not the speaker stand in the way of your word, but give us perfect health, logical progression of thought, insight into your word. And then, Father, let this not just be a moment where we hear your word, but let it be followed by a lifestyle that transitions to who you would have us to be. And we'll give you praise in Christ's name. Amen. I remember once being out with Dr. Tony Evans, and he started a sermon off analyzing a nursery rhyme. And so what I want to do is pick up where he left off as we analyze the dynamics of a nursery rhyme, but I want to take it a little bit further. Start off with this discussion about a dude named Mr. Dumpty. First name, Humpty. Humpty Dumpty sat on a wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall, and all of the king's horses and all of the king's men tried to put Humpty back together again. Now, in the story, it is very clear that Mr. Dumpty was a very important person, because if all of the king's horses, that means the army, and all of the king's men, that means the talent, were trying to put him back together again, then he had to be an important element. Dr. Evans spent a lot of time talking about the king's horses and the king's men. But I want to take a little bit of a different angle on this. Because I think, first of all, I don't know why Mr. Dumpty would sit on a wall in the first place if he was that fragile. But let's suppose it wasn't his fault. Let's suppose he was living and it was 2020. 2020... No matter what wall you were sitting on, you probably fell off. The question is, how do we put it back together again? Now, my argument is that Mr. Dumpty apparently had the wrong king, because he was trying to put it together with all the king's horses, and all the king's men, and all of the king's horses and all of the king's men could not put it back together again. It didn't say they didn't. It said they couldn't do it. So I propose that perhaps he had the wrong king. Maybe Mr. Dumpty should have changed his citizenship so that his king had the ability to put together even what falls apart when it comes off the wall. Our thesis today is this. We who are under the lordship of Christ are called to a higher citizenship. Like once you get under the lordship of Christ, your citizenship elevates. Therefore, biblical principles must be applied to issues of politics, matters of government, and how we approach the ballot box. That means I no longer can do that based on this citizenship only. But because I'm called to a higher citizenship, then everything I think about regarding this citizenship need to be filtered through that higher citizenship. The question we really want to ponder on today is this. What are the key principles that will help us honor our primary citizenship, our citizenship of Christ, our primary citizenship calling, and biblically fulfill our responsibilities in our earthly citizenship? In other words, God said, when I called you to a higher citizenship, I didn't tell you to quit this one. So you have a responsibility here, but here's the difference. The responsibility that you have here must be filtered through the responsibility that you have there. And so what I want to really do is cover three things today that relate to our responsibility in our higher citizenship as it relates to this one. How do we approach it having the right principles in mind to ensure that when we get to the ballot box, then we're doing the right things? Now, let me clarify some things to take away your suspense. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for. Amen. What I want to do is help you understand God's expectations of you as citizens in his kingdom when it comes to your responsibility as citizens in this world. So we'll start off with number one. And let's just grab this one because we spent a little time on this one. It is the first thing you have to recognize. Here's the first principle. Principle number one. Catch this. Allegiance regarding our citizenship must be viewed through a hierarchical lens. Let me explain what I mean. In citizenship on earth, everybody is the same. However, your allegiance to the United States of America should be greater than your allegiance to, say, Russia. Or should be greater than anybody else. So it takes this hierarchical position and it becomes your identity in the world as it relates to citizenship. When you are called by God, you are called to a heavenly citizenship. So therefore, the rules and the guidelines that you are following are no longer limited to the earthly guidelines here, but there's a higher calling, which means another calling, which means you are expected to be more a citizen of God's rule than you are a citizen here on earth. And let me explain this. There are some things that are permissible in this citizenship on earth that are not permissible in God's kingdom. So therefore, you will only do what God permits you to do in spite of what's offered in this citizenship on earth. Let me give you another twist to it. There are some things that God demands that you do in his citizenship that here on earth will contradict God's expectations. So if God expects for you to do something based on his kingdom, and the world expects for you to do something based on this kingdom, then what God is saying is the hierarchy, the one that trumps out everything, is God's kingdom. Amen. Okay? So you must view it in a hierarchical lens. They are not side by side. Like people talk about dual citizenship. No, there's no, this is number one. And what's permissible here helps you determine what you can do here. All right? To the hierarchical lens. Here's the way God puts it. Philippians chapter 3, verse number 17, as was read in your hearing earlier. It says, "For, as I've told you before, and now I tell you again, even with tears." He said, I'm so upset about it, so sorrowful about it, that I got tears in my eyes. And here's the problem. Many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Now, you say, well, a whole lot of people ain't saved. No, he ain't saying that. Well, I love Jesus. He ain't arguing that either. He didn't say you were an enemy of Christ. He says you're enemies of the cross of Christ. Now, so the question is, what did the cross of Christ do? The cross of Christ is the vehicle that gave you citizenship rights in the kingdom. You see what I'm saying? In other words, he went and paid the price so that you could be a citizen, and you're still living like you're in another kingdom when you're supposed to be, the hierarchy is supposed to be him. So things that he wouldn't tolerate, then you are doing, and that makes you function as an enemy of what he did to get you here. You mean I paid for you to get in and you ain't going? Now here's the deal. My kids were in school, elementary school and everything else. I mean, I was a little frustrated when they didn't do the, you know, they didn't do the work and all this kind of stuff. But when kids go to college, amen, the price is different. Amen. You pay for public school through your taxes, so you really kind of get hijacked off of that. You don't even really see the money. It's taken from you. But you write that check every month. And you know that if you're like many parents, especially African-American parents, then you, other than that scholarship, that student loan, amen, a good portion of it going to be yawn. So you're going to be paying that bad boy even to get out. And then one day you creep up on the college campus and find them just kicking it. They ain't going to class. They ain't doing, they just kicking it. That hurts a whole lot differently because you recognize this price. I'm paying all this money for you. You could have partied at home. I could have gave you a corner in the basement to do that. Here I am paying all this money for you to stay in the dorm, for you to get all your books, for you to do all this kind of stuff. And here it is, with all that I paid, amen, got me a little upset. Jesus says, listen, I went to the cross for this. Like, you, like your citizenship wasn't free. I went to the cross for this. When they was beating me, I was silent. So you can go. So you can be a citizen. When they nailed me, I just laid there. So you could be a citizen. And now you acting like you don't even like, amen, my citizenship? He said you're acting like an enemy. But you're like, I mean, I'm not an enemy. I love the Lord. He ain't talking about loving the Lord. He's talking about whether you act like a citizen or not. Here's some of the things he says we do when we're not acting like citizens. First of all, he says their destiny is destruction. In other words, in the kingdom, the destiny has to do with glory and has to do with, you know, the destiny of the kingdom really is to get other people in. So it's not destroying other people. He says their God is their stomach, greedy. What's in it for me? He says the glory is their shame. They brag about things that they should be hiding. And their mindset on earthly things. All they're thinking about is stuff down here. He says, but our citizenship is in heaven. He says, that's the conflict. Right. And we should eagerly await a Savior
from there.
What? That means that the dilemmas that I get in on earth are not going to be resolved by earthly matters. I'm waiting for deliverance from there. He says, it is one Lord, one King, Jesus Christ. So here's a question. Now you say, but I'm not an enemy of the cross. Well, what does it look like when you're enemy of the cross? That's the question we want to ponder on just a little bit. First thing, he says your destiny is destructive. That means that if you are always a win-lose kind of person, then you got a problem. Like the goal of God's kingdom is to recruit. So all you really want to do is beat people. If you're a win-lose person, if that's how you address government, if that's how you address the polls, if that's how you address your political element is, I'm going to beat you, then you got your kingdoms mixed up. Because it's not about win or lose, it's about recruiting. So our goal, and I'm not trying to make you a Democrat or a Republican, I'm trying to get you into this citizenship. I'm trying to recruit you into this kingdom. So therefore, my thinking is not to win people over, nor do I look at people who disagree with me as enemies or people who agree with me as friends, because it's not a win-lose situation. It is about recruitment into the kingdom. Second thing, so let me say this as a caveat. That means that if my politics get in the way of me recruiting people to the kingdom, then I've gone too far. We'll talk about that a little bit more. We've gone too far. All right. Second thing is that God is the stomach. Your God, your stomach. Do you think what's in it for me? Are you self-centered? See, once your stomach, and he uses the stomach to define greed. Because if your stomach is hungry, it changes the dynamic of everything. Like, how hungry you are determine how bougie you are when it comes to eating. I mean, I've heard people say, well, I only drink bottled water. Yeah, you get thirsty enough, you're going to call our water bottled water. You know. Some folks say, man, I don't eat certain name brand foods. Like, mama used to get cereal from the commodity truck. And the name of it was, the brand was cereal. And people made fun of folks because the brand name was cereal. They're like, I don't eat that. I eat Cheerios and the Captain Dude, whatever his name was, but Captain Crunch. And I was like, dude, if you over my house, you're going to eat cereal brand cereal. And if you don't want to eat that, then fine. We will eat it in front of you while you sit over there. Now, after we got down and we slurping on the bowl and getting down to the end, you're going to be like, let me go and have some of that cereal bread. Because all of a sudden now, when you get hungry, it begins to change the way you think. A bologna sandwich can taste like steak if you're hungry enough. Even when you're not in dire straits, your stomach will affect your decision. If you don't believe me, go shopping hungry. You'll be buying stuff you didn't even think of. You know, you go in there, look, I'm just going to get a couple things. And while you're walking down the aisle, you are persuaded because of your hunger to get yourself into stuff that you ain't got no business eating. Amen. You ain't got no money for it. It'll get the best of you. In fact, when we eat, our hunger gets the best of us. That's why many of us are unhealthy. Amen. Because we don't eat based on what our body needs. We eat based on our hunger. I remember we used to go to, when they first came out with the all-you-can-eat, me and Pastor Gatchin, I think Andre went with us sometime, Wayne White, we go down there, and we would go to all-you-can-eat, and I'm telling you, we would eat all we could. You look around, and if people could move, you'd be like, you gonna get some more? Yeah, we're gonna get some more. So we all we eat. And then we'd be walking out, barely walk. You know, you sit down. You get out of the car. You pull up at your house. You just sit there in the car for a little bit. Woo! Woo! Well, that was good. No, it wasn't. It wasn't good. And you don't even feel good because you ate so much. And the only thing you could do is sleep. Now, you definitely didn't eat based on your body needs, your biological needs. You ate based on your hunger. Chinese people figured that out real quickly. And they opened up all those, all you can eat. And boy, we fell in love with China. They like rice? Give them rice. Yeah, they like salt? Give them salt. Put some soy. And so they were just feeding us what we wanted. And we were just taking it in. Now all of us got high blood pressure, weight problems, and all those different kinds of things because we really were eating based on our hunger. So when he says, your God is your stomach, that means you're being ruled by your hunger. Amen. If you go to the polls, if you begin to vote, if you look at your politics, all of it based on your hunger. Rest based on what's rather than what's best for you overall, then you've missed the point. That means that you forgot about your key citizenship. The third thing is their glories and their shame. Lord Jesus, proud of unbiblical things. You ever hear people talk about the good old times? People don't say, man, the good old times was when we used to be in church and praising God and loving it. No. Good old time. Remember that time we robbed 7-Eleven? And remember that time, maybe you got some different good old time. Remember that time we got so high that we didn't know where we were and we woke up in the park? Or maybe you got some different good old time. Remember that time we drank a whole, a fifth of 190 proof grain alcohol? Y'all ain't got those good old times? Well, maybe your good old time is small. Remember that time I lied to my mama? Remember that time we skipped school? Remember that time I was deceptive? Remember that time I was telling them one thing and thinking another thing in my head? We love to talk about our sin trophies because that's where we think our glory is. And what God is saying is, you are so earthly that it's easier for you to remember the time of your sin, your darkness, than it is for you to remember the price on the cross. And then the last thing is he said, your mindset is on earthly things. You're carnally focused. You think about, you know, it's kind of like a person who got married and still thinking they're single. I'll be honest, once I got married, like I when I was single, I dressed so that other people would like what I had on. Now, here's the problem with that. I have really bad taste. like we said. So my orange and green look good to me. Amen. My wife had pity on me and took me anyway. But once I got married, now I'm dressing to please her. Y'all get it? Because now I'm in a covering, which means that it becomes a priority over everything else. So even if I please the world and didn't please her, I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do. Same thing. You are now a citizen in the kingdom. If you don't please God and get a bunch of likes on your Facebook page, if a bunch of followers on your Instagram and everybody Instagram, everybody subscribes to your YouTube, but God is not happy with you, then you are missing the role of your citizenship. You are an enemy of the price that was paid to get you in. All right, so we get that. So here's point number two. Point number two is this. We are called to be productive, prosperous, and prosperous in the land in which we live, our earthly citizenship. If I look just like everybody else, then the value of my citizenship with God disappears. See, the reason why a lot of folks ain't trying to get on the Christian bandwagon is because they've seen Christians. Like, yeah, I saw y'all. Y'all just as broke as I am. Y'all don't know how to manage y'all budget either. You know, I see y'all get divorced as much as we do. I see y'all can't regulate your emotions. You jump into things you ain't got no business jumping into, and then you go off when you ain't supposed to be going off. I mean, you don't love each other, you don't care for each other. Folks go, you just watch your friends just go straight down the gutter. You just like a club. I used to go to the club every Friday and meet up with the people every Friday, and we holler together, dance together, sweat together, all this kind of stuff. Then we leave, and then we see each other next week. So I might as well go to the club while you go to church, because the results are the same. I don't see you doing anything different from me. And the only thing you talk about is heaven's your home. There's a leak in this old building. No, dude, what the Bible says is you need to live a productive, prosperous life while you're here. Now, prosperity is not your goal, but wherever God plants you, you should be blooming there. In Jeremiah 29, verse number 4, it says this. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all of those who were carried away exiled from Jerusalem to Babylon. So here's some folks who they were carried away from Africa to America. From Jerusalem to Babylon. They were carried away. And they were captive there. But if you say, but I wasn't carried away, but you here. So bloom where you planted. That's his point, is bloom where you planted. Don't try to bloom in Texas if you live in Kansas City. All right? He says, build houses and settle down. Amen. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Then he says, marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your wives, your daughters in marriage. And then he says, so that they too will have sons and daughters. He says, I want you to increase. Increase in number right there and do not decrease. Then here's what I want you to do. I want you to seek the peace of the city, peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you away into exile. Who carried you away into exile? You ain't there by accident. You are here because I put you here. So quit trying to go somewhere else and think about what you need to do to bloom where you're planted. Then he says, pray to the Lord, your Lord, for the city that you live in. Pray for it. And he says, and this is why. Because if it prospers, you too will prosper. But you say, wait a minute. I've been asking for blessings for me. I've been asking that. I ain't been praying that the whole school system would do better. I just want my kid to get a good education. I ain't praying that the whole neighborhood would improve. I just don't want my kids to suffer. I ain't praying that everybody would have prosperity. I'm just praying that I would. He says, no. There's an if there. If it prospers, you will. So don't be just praying for you. Pray for the city that you're in so that prosperity takes place on a global level. Y'all with me? So our citizenship. So here's the deal. When people see us, they should make decisions based on the decisions that we make, because they see the result of our decisions because we're in a higher citizenship. If we are just like them, everybody's even. Y'all follow me? So when you think about your politics, the goal is what's better for everybody. The goal is what's better for the whole community. The goal is what's better for the bigger picture. I'll give you an example. We just finished our census, and we were constantly pushing to get an expansion of the gathering of the census, but from the White House, took it to the courts, Supreme Court, to cut off the census gathering. And the reason why is because in many cities, especially urban cities, then many of the folks have not completed the census. And there's a lot of reasons why, but I don't get into that. But here's the deal. In Kansas City, we completed 60% out of 100. 60% of the folks in Kansas City completed the census. Now, what difference does that make? Because that means we get 60% of the funding for schools, 60% of the funding for all of the federal government programs that come down to our community, 60% of the federal matching funds to help us with highways and all this kind of stuff. So the result of that is if you want to get stuff done, you're going to have to increase the taxes because we didn't participate. Now, why didn't people participate? I ain't telling them. They ain't getting my business. I ain't filling this out. I don't want them to know how many people in the house. So what you're saying is you would let the city fall short because you didn't want nobody to know your last name. Because you didn't want, you know what I'm saying? I mean, those things, so when we think about those things, we got to move away from thinking just about me and start thinking globally because God says bloom where you're planted. Now, you can't bloom in a raggedy garden. I'm going to stay in this garden. And I'm going to be the only flower that has good soil. No, no. The soil around you is going to affect you. And so what we've been trying to do is we get raggedy, mess up our soil, and then we go try to move to a place where there's good soil and think, if we move out here, then my plant will grow. But the reason why the other soil was bad, because, hey, amen, you was there. It was this guy who was telling me, he's like, man, everywhere I go, I smell something funny. I said, you smell all the time? He said, yeah. I said, everywhere you go? He says, yeah. Do you smell in the morning when you get up and nobody's there but you? Yeah. When you go to bed, you still smell? Yeah. Well, what's around you every time you smell it? I don't know. I do. I think wherever you are, that smell is there. So what you need to do is figure out what's in you that's bringing that smell with you on a regular basis everywhere you go. Some of us are spiritually like that. Everywhere I go, amen, I spiritually stink. We blame it on the devil. The devil ain't got to work that hard for you. You're like, man, the devil just is busy. No, you've given him a day off. You're doing so much stuff, you're like, oh, I ain't even gonna get up today. They're fine on their own. Amen. So it's our responsibility to kick out. We should be different. Now, here's the other thing, the third thing, and that is this. God's kingdom agenda will not be achieved through politics or government. Here's our biggest deal. Most of us think we are so passionate about who we vote for, who we like, and all those different kinds of things, that we, and then we'll have our issues, whether it be abortion or whether it be slavery or whether it be racism. And we really think that if we get the right person in office, pass the right laws, then it'll go away. But let me tell you, abortion will decrease when hearts are changed. So it doesn't matter that in 1970, whatever, then Roe versus Wade passed, and the Christians have been up in arms about fighting Roe versus Wade because we think that's the worst thing that's ever happened. We have stopped paying attention to what the real solution is, which is changing hearts, and start arguing with the people who could be with us in the real solution, and we're divided over issues that if we were together, we could solve. Because we have put all our eggs in the government basket. If we just pass this law, if we just turn over Roe versus Wade, then we will stop abortion. No, you won't. You didn't stop slavery. Amen. Emancipation Proclamation was a little ways ago. So I think we got to begin to think about the fact that I can't be so committed to the government fixing the problem that we demolish the church relationships. Let me say it again. The proposed solution is killing the real solution. And the government, we allowed the government to solve church problems. We allowed all our social issues, housing, feeding the poor, caring for the homeless, all those different kinds of things, we allowed the government to do it. And now we depend on the government to do it. In other words, we turned our jobs over to them, and now what they said is we ain't gonna do it the way we promised. And we get mad at them. Well, they could turn to us and say, y'all supposed to do it in the first. I'm doing your job. Hey, look. There'd be something if I told my child, look, you need to keep your room clean. It's their job to clean their room. And then I came in one day and said, look, I'm going to clean your room for you. And I started cleaning the room. And they came back in there and said, man, you ain't cleaning it right. I'm like, dude, first of all, give me my belt and then get in here and you start cleaning it. Because you were supposed to do it in the first place. How can we complain about the government? I search folks looking around. All these homeless people. Them your people. The Bible says we, the poor is with us always. We should be taking care of them. Amen. We complain because the government arrested everybody who used crack and helping everybody who used opioid. And it's a clear picture that one is a white pattern drug and the other one is the other pattern drug. I mean, when you look at stuff like meth, meth is blowing up stuff. And it still did not reach the pinnacle of penalties that crack did. Because crack was a ghetto thing. We're over-policed. We think enforcement is going to change people so that people will act better. They'll stop killing each other if we have more police. No, they won't. Because they ain't killing each other because we ain't got enough police. They're killing each other because their hearts are broken. And they have not had a taste of the real kingdom. And here we are arguing with people who are supposed to be a part of the same kingdom about the solution as to whether it should be carnal or whether it should be kingdom. Here's what he says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19. And I'm cutting in the middle of a context here. He says, and his incomparable great power for us who believe. In other words, God has power for us who believe, that cannot be compared to anything else. He says that power is the same is the same as the mighty strength that he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly realms. He says so that this power that God has is the same power that was used to put you in a position to be a part of the heavenly kingdom. Wow. He says, and it's far above any election. Far above any rule, any authority, any power, any dominion, and name something else. He says, in every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the age to come. Not only now, but when you get to heaven. Then he says, and God placed all things under Christ's feet and appointed him to be head over everything, but not to everybody, not to governments, not to organizations, but to the church, to his people gathered together. He said, why? Because that's his body. That's his physical presence on earth. And it is the fullness of him. It is how the idea of Christ works his way out in the most practical ways. And it is the tool through which everything will be fulfilled to its fullest. So therefore, would we compromise the church for the sake of politics? Recognizing that even if you got your way politically, it's not going to achieve the kingdom objective. And that's what we've done. We don't like people because they like this person. We stop talking to people because of this, whatever. All those different kinds of things. I'm so mad at him. We calling each other's names. We're doing all this kind of stuff. You know, now you got white evangelical versus black evangelicals. You got, all this stuff that's going on. And y'all talking about Satan busy. Satan done took a vacation. He's out in the Bahamas somewhere. Like, they doing it themselves. You don't have to destroy the church. We'll do it. So God tested us then. I ain't going to let you gather in your building right now. So therefore, the message of the church has to be bigger than your clique. So here we are. Now, I'll be on that topic for a little bit. We'll talk a little bit more, but I wanted to address a few questions that have come my way. So I'm going to try to address three questions, and they're on your worksheets. Right there. Here's the three common questions that I get most of the time regarding politics. Here's the first one. First one is, does character matter? Does character matter? And because some people say character don't really matter if you just look at their politics. You just look at the decisions they make, politics or whatever. And so the expanded version of the question is can you forget about a person's character and just focus on their policies? And my answer is to the question of whether character matters is a gleaming yes, character matters. Our primary calling in Christ is centered around character from the fruit of the Spirit and the so-called seven deadly sins. And so if I reflect the seven deadly sins but agree with your policies, then the question is do you see me being aligned with you? That means that if the Old Testament saints would have cut a deal with Nebuchadnezzar, God would have been happy. If Hitler agreed with my policies, I should be okay with that. What about Margaret Sanger, who came up with the whole abortion idea to eliminate black people? What if she agreed with my policies? What if I cut a deal with the Klansman, who was the head honcho? And he says, okay, I tell you what, I'll get blacks down on the corner of the country. And I said, okay, all right, okay. And then cut a deal with him. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you just can't say, whoever it is, as long as they agree with my policies, I'm good. That is not what a kingdom person focuses on. There's an entire section of the Old Testament law that focuses only on character. So even when God was leading a nation, he was still concerned about that. Here's the second question is, and I get this a lot, is it biblical to protest the government? I mean, should we be marching on the plaza and all this kind of stuff? And before I do that, let me go back to the character question, and I want to read Ephesians 5, verse number 8, just give you a reference on this whole topic. It says this. It says, you were once in darkness. You used to be like them. And then he says, but now you are a child. You are in the light. You are light in the Lord. Excuse me. You are light in the Lord. That means when you are in the Lord, then people begin to see things that are biblical that they didn't see in you before. And he says, so live as children of light. In other words, highlight that. And he says, for the fruit of the light consists of all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And then he says, and find out what pleases the Lord rather than what pleases you. Talk about all this stuff. Then he says, have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness. In other words, he said, don't fool around in that stuff. He says, but rather expose them. Help people understand what this looks like. He says, it is shameful to even mention what the disobedient do in secret. He says, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible. In other words, if we live so differently than everybody else because we have light shining on us, then it makes the bad thing looks visible. I'll give you an example. If you're talking to me, like I'm not going to sit and have a screaming match with you. I'm just not. It's just not what I do. But if you're screaming at me and I'm talking calmly to you, who looks crazy? Now, some people are going to say, she went off on him. But really, when you look at it, you look like the paddy wagon need to pick you up and put you in a white room. And I could really be the crazy person. I didn't say anything. But your ignorance is exposed by my composure, if you know what I mean. And so he says that everything that is illuminated becomes a light. In other words, once you become illuminated, God's light shines through you, it becomes light. So the protest with the government, yes, it's a biblical protest. Protest is permissible. Let me give you just one example here in Acts chapter number 16. Now, in Acts chapter number 16, what happened is Paul and Silas were unjustly beat up by the police. Amen. Y'all heard that somewhere along the way. They were unjustly beat up by the police, and they threw him in jail, right? And then, so after they'd done all these bad things to him, then they come out and say, let him go. And so here's what he says. When it was daylight, the magistrates sent the officers to the jail with an order, release those men. And the jailers told Paul, the magistrates have an order that you and Silas can be released. He says, now you can leave and go in peace. And Paul said to the officers, wait a minute, hold up. Hold up, y'all. He said, they beat us publicly without a trial. And he says, even though we were Roman citizens, we are Americans. And you treated us like we're in a war zone. And now you want to say, okay, forgive us and move on. He says, and then you threw us in the prison. Locked me up all night. Kept me for the weekend because it was a Friday. And then he says, and now you want to get rid of us quietly? Paul's like, no, I ain't going nowhere. He said, tell them to come down here and we're going to deal with them that way. In other words, you don't have to sit around just because they are authority, they're government, whatever. We don't have to sit around and just take it. And I think that the younger generation, when I talk to the young folk, they ain't going to take what we took. Like, we were just happy to be, you know, they beat us up and, you know, everything else. And we were like, look, I'm going to let you go, boy, so you go on home. We were just happy to be gone. Okay. We just happy to be going home. Now, they stopped us for nothing. They've been doing that for years. Stop us, make you get out of your car, search you, do all that stuff, put the knee on your boot on your knee, all the boot on your neck, all that stuff. This generation, I ain't getting that. Your mama said, look, shut up and do what they say. And that's what we did. So now that they're pushing against, now here's the bigger issue. This is the first generation that did not grow up in a segregated America. So they don't know what we used to know. We were just happy that we got more than what we used to, because we remember segregation. And so now they don't remember all that. So they're like, look, it's stupid for me to get less than everybody. It doesn't even make sense. It doesn't even register. And so now it's time for the policies to move towards a better direction. Here's the other thing. How do I know that my policies are going too far? I'm going too far in my politics. Here's the answer to that is when your political differences break the bond of peace between believers. When your identity as a Democrat or Republican supersedes your identity in the kingdom. You know, I have people, I am provoked often on Facebook to get into a bashing. People want me to bash Trump. Some people want me to bash Obama. They want me to bash anybody. They just try to find, you know. And I was like, look, here's the deal. Unfortunately, our president has normalized name calling, you know, bullying and all that kind of stuff. I ain't buying it. Sometime I'd like to, but the kingdom I'm in, I'm a citizen in another kingdom. So even though it's become normalized and permissible here, I ain't doing it. It's like, well, you just scared to say. You just indecisive. You just, you know, all this stuff. And sometimes my feeling, my hunger, my stomach make me want to say, oh, you want to, oh, we can do it now. We can go. But then I'm in this other kingdom. So my citizenship, somebody even said to me, you know, you always falsely, like I'll point out things that are deficient. I won't say Maurice did it or Robert did it. But I point out, this is a bad thing. It's normalized, but it's a bad thing. And if the shoe fits, wear it. And they'll say, well, you point out things that are bad, but then you go to this fake honor in not bashing people. I'm like, no, no, no. I will call out sin, but I'm not going to start demoralizing people's names. I want to. No, don't get me wrong. I want to. But it's this kingdom thing. I'm a citizen. Here's what he says, and we'll say this in closing. Ephesians 4, chapter 3, verse number 6, kind of a scripture that supports the last thing. He says, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. The bond of peace is what keeps the Spirit unified. So if we got white evangelicals, black evangelicals, Hispanic evangelicals, all this kind of stuff, if you begin to divide up that way, then the unity of the Spirit is dead. So he says, so how do you keep the unity of the Spirit together? He says, the bond of peace. That means when we can get along, we are in a position with that peace that keeps the bond together. He says, because there's only one body, one Spirit, and he says, we are all called to one hope. And that hope is not to have who you want in office. And he says, when you were called, he says, we have one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. So as we think about the ballot box, We have a responsibility. Look, do not neglect your responsibility to bloom where you planted. Go in that booth and do something. Take your kids and let them understand what to do. We need to do better. If we only did 60% of the census, then that means we have less to complain about when we only get 60% of the value. I would hate for us to get less than 60% of us voting, because then we can't complain about the outcome. So get to the booth and vote. Now, I encourage everybody to vote early. Look, don't wait for it. I've seen these. I don't know if you've seen the news in some of the other states. Listen, they have cut down on the mailing drop boxes. They cut down the box. Some states, you have to drive an hour both ways to drop your ballot off, because the voter suppression, that's what they're doing. Let's keep these other folks who we don't think will make our decision from having an opportunity to voice their decision. I don't care what your decision is in the booth. I care more about whether or not you are blooming where you're planted. And that's what God tells us to do. So you need to show up in a booth, but keep those principles in mind as you make decisions about your political life and the view of government and all the different kinds of things, that you are a citizen in a higher kingdom, even though that's supposed to show up in this carnal world. Don't let your hunger guide your shopping. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for the time together. We thank you for your word. Not a passionate message, but hopefully it sank in and give us some guidelines on how to think about not only the politics that are national politics, but also the local elements that are taking place. We're dealing with crime, working with the mayor, with all those different kinds of things that are going on are significantly important to us. And so we ask, Lord, that you would guide us so that we reflect you. We want to have nothing to do with the evil things, the darkness, but to carry our light in such a way to where we expose the things that people need to grow from, so that they will become accompanying advocates with us in your kingdom. And we'll give you praise in Christ's name. Amen. If you're here today and you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, right above me, you will see our website, cfbckc.org. Get in touch with us. We love to connect with you. If you have questions, if you have comments, if you have anything, we love to connect with you. But most importantly, if you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, then guess what? The door is still open. I mean, God is offering great opportunity to change your eternity. And even more so than that, you get to live a biblical life every day. And so we'll see you on next week. Our Bible study is Wednesday morning, Wednesday evening. You can find the connections on our website for that as well.